We are looking at chapter number 6, which is work, energy and power. Work, energy and power. So these are the words work, energy and power. In everyday language, we use them normally, like farming or construction, or student even studying for some competitive exam, an artist which is painting a beautiful landscape. They all are working. We are always working. Even if we are sleeping, we are working. But in physics, the work, this word work has a very definite and precise meaning. We can say that somebody who has a capacity to work for say 14 to 16 hours has good stamina. The person who can only work for 2-3 hours, he may not be having good stamina or energy. Okay. So energy is what? Energy is our capacity to do work. But in physics, the term energy is related in this sense only. Means the work, capacity to do work. But the word which is called as work has some meaning. And along with this, we talk about power. So power has also different shades, like when we are playing, say, karate or boxing, then we say give or use powerful punches. That is, you deliver it with great speed. So these are the different shades of meaning of word power. So we'll see that there is a correlation between all these words, that is work, energy and power, how they are related, what are the definitions, what are the physical quantities that they represent, and how they are related. Before we go ahead, let us know the scalar product of two vectors. Scalar product. So physical quantities like the displacement, that is d, velocity and acceleration, and force. These are all vectors, and we have already seen how to add and subtract the vectors. Now we'll see how we can multiply the vectors. So there are two ways. One is called the dot product, one is called the cross product. So first is the scalar product gives a scalar when two vectors and the other unknown as the other known ways the vector product produces a new vector from two vectors. I am saying when two vectors are multiplied, you get a scalar, and when you multiply two vectors across, you get a vector. So these are the two ways. So here we take the scalar product of two vectors. The scalar product or dot product, see, I have used a dot here, I have used a cross here. This is called the dot product. So dot product of any two vectors, say A and B, this is denoted by A dot B, A dot B. And this simply means A dot B means AB cos theta. What is this AB cos theta? See, this is A and this is B. So this is the angle between these two vectors. So what is the component of B on A? If this is theta, it is B cos theta. So A into B cos theta. Or you can say, if this is A, this is B, what is the component of A on B? That is A cos theta. So B into A cos theta. Similar way, A dot B can be represented as A B cos theta. That is the component of B on A, and B into A cos theta. That means component of A on B. As you see here, this is B, this is B cos theta. So A into B cos theta. In this case, we have A and the cos component is A cos theta. This A cos theta is multiplied by B. This is your scalar product. You can say the projection. Okay. The scalar product are commutative. That is A dot B is equal to B dot A. Also, scalar product obeys the distributive law. A dot B plus C is A dot B plus A dot C. A dot lambda B is equal to, you can take lambda out. This is A dot B. Lambda can be any real number. And ijk, if these are unit vectors, then if you take dot product of I and I, that is going to give you 1, Likewise, j dot j and k dot k will give you 1. The simple reason is I dot I is I into I into cos. What is the angle between the same vectors? It is 0. So you get, this is magnitude, because this is a unit vector, you get 1, here 1, and cos 0 is also 1. So you get 1. That is how. And when you talk about ijk, that is, this is I, unit vector along x-axis, this is j and this is k. Now, if you take this j and k, the angle between them is 90 degree. So when you take the dot product, this gives you j, k and cos 90 degree. So the magnitude is 1, here 1, cos 90 is 0. So every time if you take ij, jk or kj, you will get 0 because of cos 90 degree. The component of A in terms of say in the xyz axis can be represented as axi, ayj and azk. Similarly, B can be written as bxi, byj and bzk. When you take the scalar product of these two, what we have to do is we have to multiply each term by each term, means axi into axi into a bxi, axi into byj, axi into bzk. But you see here, ii will give you 1, otherwise ij and ik will give you 0. So when you take a dot product, only this term and this term will remain, because this is going to give you 1 value, I into I is 1. But if you multiply I with J, you are going to get 0. So only AX, BX, AY, BY and AZ, BZ will remain. And if we have A dot A, that is, you multiply this with this again, it is going to give you A square, which is simply AX, AX, that is AX square, AY, AY, AY square, AZ, AZ, AZ square. Others are going to be 0. So when you take this A dot A, this is simply A, magnitude of A and cos 0, because same vector we are talking about, A vector and again A vector. So what are the angles between them? This is 0 degree. Angle with the same vector is 0 degree. So you get A square. But if you take A dot B and A, B are perpendicular, if A and B are perpendicular, we say it is 0. Or we can also say that if A dot B is 0, then they are supposed to be perpendicular to each other. One question is there, find the angle between force, that is F. This is given by in a vector form unit, and displacement is given like this. Also find the projection of F on D. Projection of F on D is F cos theta into D. And it means F into D cos theta. So F dot D, because we have to find the, because F and D is given. So let us find out first F dot D. F dot D give you Fx dx, Fy dy, Fz dz. Take this value, 3 into 5, 4 into 4, 5 into 3. So what do you get? You get some 16 here. Okay. This is, these are the value 3, 4, 5 you have used and 5, 4, 3. So this is, just consider this to be say minus 3. If some mistake is there in your book. So just ignore the number, just multiply these coefficients. So you get some 16 unit. Now F dot D is what? See, F dot D, if you take the dot product, you get F D cos theta. So 16 unit can be equated with F D cos theta. F D cos theta is 16. But what this F dot F means, F square, F X square, F Y square, F Z square, this gives you this one, 9 square, Fy square, that is 60, 14 square. If you consider this to be 5, you get 25. In this similar manner, D, 5 square plus 4 square plus 3 square. So D dot D gives you this one, 15 unit. So what is the cos theta? Cos theta, if you want to find out cos theta, it will be F dot D by magnitude of F and magnitude of T. Okay. So this magnitude of F and D, if you see F square, this F square gives you 50. So what is F? It is under root 50. Similarly, this is D dot D, that is from here, it is D square, so D comes to be under root 50. So this is F, this is D, means this is F, this is D, magnitude. And F dot D we have just found out as 16. So 16 by under root 50, you get some 0.32, and you just take cos inverse here, you get theta. notions of work and energy, the work energy theorem. We know that in a rectilinear motion, we have acceleration as a, so we can always write v square is equal to u square plus 2as, or v square minus u square equal to 2as. This v is the final velocity, u is the initial velocity, a is the acceleration, s is the distance being traveled. Now multiply both sides by m by 2. What do you get? Half mv square minus half mu square is equal to ma into s. Ma is what? This is force. Force equal to ma. So let us write it as f into s. So we have used the second law of motion, f equal to ma here. And v square minus u square is 2. Well, we want to generalize it to say other dimensions also. So in three dimensions, we can employ the vectors. We have to employ vectors. So this will become a dot d, because we are employing vector, not simply as. It has to be in vector form. That is why it is bold. And there is a dot product between them. Now again, multiply both sides by m by 2. So you get half mv square minus half mu square equal to m into ad. But ma is f, so you get f dot d. Now these are the equations where we can arrive at the definition of work and energy. So this is the difference of what? This is the left sides are simply the difference of half the mass into velocity. Okay, the initial half the mass velocity minus final half mass of the velocity, and this is called the kinetic energy. We'll learn about this more, but for the time's sake, these are the kinetic energy. So what is the right hand side? This is the product of displacement and the component of force along the displacement. The component of force along the displacement, because f dot d will be eventually f d cos theta. Okay, so this quantity is nothing but work. F dot d is work. This is work, and this is simply the difference of the kinetic velocity, means final kinetic velocity minus initial kinetic velocity. It gives you work, which is eventually equal to f dot d. In one dimension it is f dot s, but in more than one dimension it is going to be f dot d. Okay, so work refers to the force and the displacement over which the body or over which the force is acting. You can say work is done by a force on a body over certain displacement. So force is acting, some displacement is there, then we say some work is being done. And this equation, simply if you say these two, are the special case of work energy theorem. The change in the kinetic energy of a particle is equal to the work done on it by net force. This is simply change in kinetic energy. This is simply change in kinetic energy. And what is the energy being changed is the work done. Let us take an example. It is well known that a raindrop falls under the influence of a downward gravitational force and the opposing resistive force. So a drop is falling. There is a resistive force which resists it. Now, latter is proportional, means resistive force is proportional to the speed of the drop, but is otherwise underdetermined. Consider a drop of mass 1 gram falling from the height 1 kilometer. It hits the ground with a speed of 50 meter per second. Now, we have to find out what is the work done by the gravitational force and what is the work done by unknown resistive force. So how to find this? See, we have just seen that the change in the kinetic energy is what? Is the work done. Okay. Now simply you can say work done is change in kinetic energy, which is equal to F into D. So delta K is what? Half mv square minus half mu square. But it is coming from rest. So u is 0. That is why we have written 0 here. So delta K is simply half into mass is 10 to the power minus 3, because it is 1 gram. So we have just changed it into the proper unit, 10 to the power minus 3, and velocity is 50, so 50 into 50, you get delta k equal to 1.25 joule. And we have just assumed that initially the drop is at rest. Now we assume that g is the acceleration due to gravity is 10 meter per second square. Now what is the work done by gravitational force? See, mg is this one, and from this height, so m, this is the height. So mg into h, force into displacement, right? So a force is mg downwards and displacement, that is h. So mgh is the work done by gravity. Again, you use mass, gravity and height. Height is also given 1 kilometer, so we change into meter. This gives you 10 joule. Now from the work theorem energy, the change in the velocity, the change in the kinetic energy is the work done. And what is the total work done? Total work done is work done by the gravity and work done by the resistive force, Wg plus Wr. This Wr is the work done by the resistive force. So how to find this Wr? We can take this here. Okay, so delta K minus Wg. Delta K we have found out to 1.25 joule and Wg as 10 joule. So 1.25 minus 10 is minus 8.75, which is negative and shows that it is in the opposite direction of the motion. Work. So work is related with the force and the displacement which this force causes. When this force acts on somebody, there is certain displacement. So just consider a force F which is acting on a mass. So if this is a body, there is a force being acting, and this is the displacement which this force is causing. So now this object undergoes a certain displacement in say positive x direction. Now what are the components of force F? This is F cos theta, the direction of displacement, and this is F sin theta, that is perpendicular to the direction of motion. So the work done by the force is defined to be the product of component of the force, that is F cos theta, in the direction of displacement and the magnitude of this displacement. We just found out that the component of F cos F is the force in the direction of displacement is F cos theta. So F cos theta into D, F dot D. So if there is no displacement, there is no work done. If there is no displacement, D equal to 0, work done is 0. So if you even try to push a very hard rigid wall, you exert all your energy, but still there is no work done. Okay. So we have to consider when work is not done. The displacement, because we have a formula, right? F dot D, you can say F cos theta, say F cos theta D, right? So the displacement is 0. The weightlifter, say if it is holding a 150 kg mass steadily in his shoulder for say 30 seconds, still because there is no work during this time, the work will be 0 in this case. If the force is 0, then what happens? A block which is moving on a very smooth horizontal plane, it not acted upon any force because there is no friction. So it may go large displacement, there is no friction force. Because the force is not there, then work is F into D, F is not there, F is 0, so work done is 0. And then the force and displacement are mutually perpendicular. That means, if we talk about this component F sin theta and this D, because this is perpendicular to the displacement, so there is the angle between these two, D and F sin theta is 0. Why? Because sin theta is 0. So no work is done. No work is done here. The force and displacement, they are mutually perpendicular, that is no work is done for pi by 2, because cos pi by 2 is 0. Suppose a block is moving on a smooth horizontal table, the gravitational force which is acting downwards like this one, the gravitational force is acting like this one, but this mg or force or gravity force is acting perpendicular to the displacement direction. That is why the work done is 0. See, if you assume moon's orbit around the earth to be perfectly circular, then the earth gravitational force does not work, does no work. Why? Because if we take this one, the moon's instantaneous displacement is always tangential, while the earth force is radially inwards, that is in towards the center of the earth, and these two are 90 degrees. That is why there is no work done. So work can both be positive, it can be negative, if because we have simply Fd cos theta. So all depends on this angle. So if theta is between 90 and 180 degree, the cos theta is negative. In various example, the force, free the frictional force which is opposing the displacement, that is when the body is moving, the friction force is always opposite to it. So the theta between these two are 180 degree. So the work done by friction is negative, because cos 180 is minus 1. The dimension of work and energy is ml square t minus 2. The SI unit, because of the famous British physicist James Prescott Joule, in his honor, the SI unit of these are Joule. Okay. So there are other physical concepts and alternative units also, because it is widely used. These are called erg. These are erg, electron volt, calorie, kilowatt hour. So we'll be coming across them in our discussion. So let us take an example. A cyclist comes to a skidding stop in 10 meters. During this process, the force of the cycle due to the road is 200 Newton and is directly opposed to the motion. How much work done or work does the road do on the cycle, and how much work does the cycle do on the road? See, first of all, if there is a cyclist, and first question is, what is the work done by the road on the cycle? Because the road is not moving, it is stagnant. We know that Fd cos theta, there has to be some displacement, there has to be some F, and this cos theta cannot be 90 degree. So here the displacement is zero for the road. So road is not acting anywhere. So the work done by road on the cycle is zero. So work done on the cycle by the road is work done by the stopping force, which is the frictional force. So there, if frictional force is there, which is only responsible for stopping the cycle. So the stopping force and the displacement, if this is movement or displacement, this is the frictional force. They are in opposite direction. You get work by this R as F d cos theta. This F is given as 200, d is the displacement 10, and cos pi is minus 1. This is pi is 180 degree. So you get minus 2000 joule. So this is the negative work that brings the cycle, or you can say it is retarding or deaccelerating the cycle in accordance with the WE theorem, work energy theorem. And as I discussed earlier, from the third law of motion, an equal and opposite force act on the road due to the cycle. The magnitude is 200 Newton, but the road is not moving, it is not undergoing any displacement. So work done by cycle on the road is zero. Kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is simply half into mass into V dot V, that is velocity product. So the kinetic energy is a scalar quantity. The kinetic energy of object is a measure of work on the object by virtue of its motion. When the body is in movement, then we say it is possessing some kinetic energy. Okay. The kinetic energy, say, of fast flowing stream, this can be used to grind corn. In a sailing boat, the kinetic energy can be used of the wind to sail the boat. So there are various kinetic energies. Let us take for example, these are all the car, this is the mass, these are the kinetic energy, and how this is formed. This is m, this is 25. So how this 6.3 into 10 to the power 5 has come? Half into mass, which is 2000 into V, velocity, 25 into 25. So half into M into V square gives you. So this is how the kinetic energy can be computed. Let us take an example first. In a ballistic demonstration, a police officer fires a bullet of mass 50 gram with speed 200 meter per second on soft plywood of thickness 2 centimeter. The bullet emerges with only 10% of its kinetic energy. What is the emergent speed of the bullet? See, the initial kinetic energy of the bullet is half mv square. Just use the mass which is given here, which is 50 gram, and the velocity, which is this one. So you get 1000 joule. But only 10% of kinetic energy remains. So 10%, that is 10 by 100, which is actually 0.1 of this 1000 is only remaining. So this is only 100 joule. So what is the final velocity Vf, and final kinetic energy is half mv Vf square, and which is equal to the 10% of this one, which is 100 joule. How to find Vf? Take 2 here, m in the denominator, take the root. So this is 63.2. So the speed is reduced by about 68%, not 90%. Work done by a variable force. So if you are assuming that always constant force is acting, it is not the case. You will get a variable force. So this is a variable force, see, this is fx force with respect to the distance or displacement. Now this force is acting variably, it is not constant. If it would have been constant, then there would have been a straight line like this or this way, but it is variating, so there is a curve. So how to go about this? What we can do here is we can divide them into different strips. Say this strip, let us take this strip, this width is delta x, this is the xi initial and final. So this is delta x, and what is the height? This is fx, say at this point. So we have fx into delta x. What is the work done? Work done is simply fx into delta x. Delta x we are taking very small. So fx is the, at this point when we have very small distance, then you can assume that fx is not variating, it is constant, it is not variable. So delta v will be fx into delta x. So how to find out the complete work done from here to here? You can integrate from xi to xf this value. So from, you can just sigma, first summation of these strips, xi to xf, fx delta x. Now again, in this case also, delta x should be so small that we can assume that the force is constant. For that, what we will do, we'll say limit delta x tends to 0. So delta x cannot be 0, but it can tend to 0. It is very small. So in this case, when we take limit delta x tends to 0 for this summation of all these strips, 1, 2, 3, 4, like to n strips, then you get fx into delta x, and these strips are simply rectangular strip. This is every time this is delta x and this is fx. So fx dx, we are starting from initial position, this position, going up to the final position, and then we are taking limit. But we know that when we take limit for sigma, it becomes integration. This is simply integration xi to xf, initial position to final position, this is fx dx. Okay. Now we have a definite integral. So this area is computed here, and this area is nothing but the work done. So this whole area is the, this shaded region is the work done. I hope you got the idea. So let us take an example. A woman pushes a trunk on a railway platform which has a rough surface. She applies a force of 100 Newton over a distance of 10 meter. So initially it starts from here. She applies a constant force till 10 meter. So this is constant. After that she becomes tired, progressively tired, and her applied force reduces linearly with a distance to 50 Newton. That is, she start from 10, go up to 20 meter. See, it is given that the total distance through which the trunk has been moved is 20 meter. So from 10 to 20, she is getting progressively tired. So from, at this point, she had some, you know, power, but it is progressively decreasing. And at this point, it becomes 50 Newton. She started with 100 Newton, but here it became 50 Newton. Plot the force applied by the woman and the frictional force, which is 50 Newton. So we plot like this. This is X. This is F, force in Newton. So in this case, 100 Newton is there and it goes up to 10 Newton. So we have a block here. Then for another 10 meter, this reduces progressively till it comes as 50 Newton. And the friction force is acting in the opposite direction. So we have to take it in the negative. So this is minus 50, this is a constant frictional force which is acting. We have to calculate the work done by two forces over 20 meter. So what we can do here is, we know that we have to find out the area of the graph of fx and dx or f and x. So in order to find out the work done by the woman, first is this area, which is ABCD, and second is this trapezium, this one, which is area CEID. This is simply half this. This is a rectangle, so we have to take 100 into 10. So this is 100 into 10. Then we have, this is a trapezium, half into sum of the parallel sides and distance between them. So sum of parallel sides here, this is 100, this is 50. So half into 100 plus 50, and the distance between them is 10. So just compute it will be 1750 joules. Now the work done by the frictional force will be what? This rectangle, lower rectangle, because it is acting as 50 newton in the negative direction, and the displacement is what, 20. So minus 50 into 20, which is minus 1000 joule, and the area on this negative side of force axis, because we have a negative sign, it is acting displace against the displacement, that is, it has to have a negative sign. Work energy theorem for a variable force. Now we know about the work and kinetic energy. To prove the work energy theorem for variable force, not constant force, but the force which is varying, we'll talk about one dimension first. So the time rate of change in kinetic energy is what? See, k is half mv square. If you take d by dt of both sides, we get dk by dt is half, this d by dt of half mv square. Half m is constant, take m outside, v square is 2v. If you take d by dt of v square, you get 2v. So 2 can get cancelled out, you get dv by dt of and v. But you know that from the Newton's second law of motion, this m, this dv by dt is what? A. M is mass, and m into a is what? Force. So we can write this as force, and this is velocity, and this velocity is what? Dx by dt, f into dx by dt. So this f into dx by dt, you get, this is dk by dt. Cancel this dt dt, you get dk equal to f dx. Dk is equal to f dx. Now integrate this from initial position to final position, ki to kf and xi to xf, both sides. So you get dk means kf minus ki, this is the definite integral, and this fdx gives you xi to xf. Now this kf minus ki, and see, this is what? Simply the work done, we know about it. So kf minus ki is work done. So this is the work energy theorem which is proved for the one dimension. Okay, let us take an example. A block of mass 1 kg moving on a horizontal surface with speed, this initial velocity is given 2 meter per second. It enters a rough patch ranging from x from 0.1 to 2.01. There is a retarding force Fr on the block on this range, which is inversely proportional to x over this range. So Fr is given by minus k by x, which is from 0.1 to 2.01, and otherwise it is 0. If you take before 0.1 and after 2.01, it is given to be 0. K is also given as 0.5 joule. What is the final kinetic energy and the speed Vf of the block as it is crossing this patch? So we have, we know that delta K, or you can say simply, you know, we'll use this formula directly. This, okay. This one we are going to use, and this one we are going to use. So Kf minus Ki, Kf minus Ki is what? Integration of Fdx. So just let me write the formula so that you understand it better. Kf minus Ki is equal to integration of f dx from initial position to final position. What is the initial position? 0.1. What is the final position? 2.01. What is the f? F is given by minus k by x. So put minus k by x here. Take ki here. So this is the final equation. Kf is equal to ki from 0.1 to 2.01 minus k by x dx. Now we know that this ki is initial kinetic energy, half vm m into vi square. And k is constant, take outside. Dx by x is log n, means integration of 1 by x is log x. And this is the natural log, that is base is e. This is the 2.0 and 0.1, these are the definite limit, just apply it. And we find out the value. This half m, you have to use mass, which is given as 1 kg. Velocity is given as 2. So just put this value, you get final velocity. This is 0.5 joule. Now this is kf. So equate this with half m vf square. Now find out the vf. Just take 2 in the numerator, m in the denominator. So you get under root take 2 kf by m. This is 1 meter per second. What is the concept of potential energy? So potential means when somebody says you have a good potential, you will do good in your life. That is suggesting the possibility or the capacity of for motion. So the potential is something which is stored, the stored energy. If you talk about a bow string, it possesses some potential energy. When it is released, the arrow would fly off with a very, very great speed. Now, Earth's crust is not uniform. It has all types of discontinuities and dislocations that are all fault lines.
So these fault lines in the earth crust, these are somewhat like compressed strings. So these are compressed springs, you can say. They have large amount of potential energy. Whenever an earthquake occurs, these fault lines, they readjust. So the potential energy is simply the stored energy by virtue of the position or configuration of the body. Whenever it comes to potential energy, you just have to understand it is a stored energy. Okay. Whenever you release this body, this energy which is stored can be seen as a kinetic energy. So, because the kinetic energy is by the virtue of motion. The gravitational force on say some ball M of mass M is mg. What is g? G is the gravitational pull or acceleration due to gravity, you can say. So, in this case, whenever we talk about a body which is near to Earth, the height is irrelevant because the radius of Earth, which is actually responsible, the distance which is responsible for the gravitational pull is quite higher than that height. So, simply when we say force, that is mass into acceleration, mass is the, you can say, weight or kg weight. So, it will be mg and a is the acceleration. So, acceleration to gravity mg. And then when you say force into displacement, that gives you work. So, mg into h. So, this is how we represent the gravitational potential of energy of an object as a function of height, which is denoted by vh. So, we will represent potential energy by vh. In various books, it is represented by p. Because the power is also represented by B, by this symbol only. So, in this case, we will represent VH as the, you can say, potential energy, and due to gravitational force, it becomes MGH. So, this H is variable, and the gravitational force, which is equal to the negative of derivative VH with respect to H, what you say is the force is minus d by dh of the energy. Okay, so this, because it is always the pull is like this, even if the it is always at the center. Now this this vh, if you take this vh as mgh and derivate it with respect to h, this h goes, so this is mg only. Why this negative sign is this? The negative sign shows that the gravitational pull or force is downwards, because whenever you release any body, it will come down to the earth. Now, say a body is at height h, now you release it. Here it is at rest, it has all mgh, but when it comes and strike earth, it has some velocity. So, how to find out? V square equal to u square plus 2, say g, and acceleration is this, height, s is height. Now, initial velocity is 0, so v square become 2gh. This gives you v square equal to 2gh. Now, when you take half mv square as the kinetic energy, which is just when it hits earth, and mgh, which is the energy here, so half mv square here, because the height is 0, there will be no potential energy. Here, the height is at most, and it is not moving, so it will be mgh only. When we equate half mv square with mgh, this is how we get the values. Okay. So, the notion of potential energy is applicable only to the class of forces where the work done against the force gets stored up as energy. Stored up, this storing or storage, the virtue of being stored as energy is the potential energy. The potential energy Vx is represented with respect to Fx, that is, this is the force. This force Fx is given by minus dV by dx. This you have to understand. This is the rate of change of, you can say, or you can say the differential of energy with respect to the displacement. Or we already know that energy was what? Force into displacement. This energy was force into displacement. The force was energy into displacement. When we take very small value, it becomes dv by dx. V is the energy here. So, when we integrate it from, say, from one position to another, xi to xf, again, we take dx here. and this dv, this is energy vi to vf. So this integration of xi to xf of fx dx gives you vi minus vf. So change in the potential energy is this value. So the work done by conservative force like the gravity depends on the initial and final position only. This shows it depends on initial and final position only. Okay. So if an object mass is released from rest from top of a smooth inclined plane, say frictionless inclined plane, say of height at height h, the speed at the bottom will be what? Under root 2gh, because we have seen v square equal to 2gh. So velocity become under root 2gh. So the bottom, at the bottom of the inclined plane, what is this? The height, if this is the height, here height is 0. So it will be only the velocity will be 0. But at the bottom of the inclined plane, it requires the kinetic energy. Okay, kinetic energy is half mv square, and we take the velocity, the different directions of the velocity, and the force is non-conservative here. So the dimension of potential energy is ml square t minus 2. The unit is joule, because it is of course an energy only, because this is same as kinetic energy or any work. So let me reiterate that the change in potential energy for any conservative force delta V is given by the negative of the work done by the force at for certain displacement. The conservation of mechanical energy. We will first take the one dimensional notion. Suppose we have a body which undergoes some displacement, say delta x, under the action of some force. We know that from work energy theorem, the change in kinetic energy delta x is fx force into the change in the position delta x. So if the force is conservative, the potential energy vx, we have already known vx was what? The delta V was what? Delta V was minus fx delta x. So minus delta V equal to fx delta x. We just saw that. Now when we add these two, this delta K and delta V, or you can say minus delta V, is going to be 0. This implies simply this, because this is equal to this. So delta K is equal to minus delta V, which gives you delta K plus delta V equal to 0. Take delta common, K plus V equal to 0. That means the kinetic energy and the potential energy of the body remains the same. If you take a path, say from xi, if this is a path, this is initial position, this is final position. So you can say the kinetic energy at initial and potential energy at initial position will be equal to the final position kinetic and potential value. So this k plus vx, that is kinetic and potential energy, this is known as TME, or total mechanical energy. Individually, this k, kinetic energy, and potential energy, this may vary from point to point. It is not that k will always remain same, v will always remain same. If this is greater, this will less. If this is greater, this will be less. Okay. But the sum will remain constant. And this term is specially for conservation. That is why we have conservation of mechanical energy here. So k plus v always remain constant. So there are some definition of this conservative force. The force fx is conservative if it can be derived from scalar quantity, the potential energy, by an equation. And this equation, assume we have already seen this equation as this one. Then the three-dimensional generalization will require the use of a vector derivative, which we'll discuss later sometime. The work done by conservative force depend only on the final and initial position, that is the endpoints. So the work done is kf minus ki, which is vxi minus vxf. This is kinetic energy difference, this is potential energy difference. And the third definition also states that the work done by this force in a closed path is zero. And we know when we have I and F common, that means this becomes equal. So ki xi equal to xf, so the work done is also zero. Okay. So let us emphasize and point the principle of conservation of total mechanical energy. This can be stated as the total mechanical energy of a system is conserved if the forces doing work on it are conservative. This is very important. Again, let me tell this to you again, that total mechanical energy of a system is conserved if the forces doing work on it are conservative. We can take say some example of a spring force. You are pressing it, it is coming back again like this. So we have this conversion of potential energy to kinetic energy of a body. If you have a mass, see, mass dropped from height. So at this point, it has the total energy as, let me tell you here. So these are the three positions. This is the highest position. So this is energy at height h. So it is at rest. So it will be mg into complete. This is the height. Now at this certain height h, it will contain the mgh, that is this height, and also half mv vh square, that is the velocity at this point. At this point the height is zero, so it will only contain half mv square. So in all, these all are equivalent. Mgh is equal to mg capital H is equal to half mv square, which in turn is equal to mgh plus half mvh square. So the constant force is, you know, in the case is specially means distance wise dependent on the force fx. So the total mechanical energy is conserved. You can say the energy, these two energy are equal. So you can equate mg capital H with half mv square. This gives you the final velocity vfs under root 2 gh, and this we have already seen. And you can you know, take these two also. With this you can find out the velocity vh square, that, or you can equate these two also, or you can put vf here, you know, you can put vf here, so that you get the vh square is equal to 2g h minus h. At certain height h, if it, the body is at rest, it is purely potential. It comes down, it has potential and kinetic energy. When it touches the ground, it has only kinetic energy. A bob of mass m is suspended by a light string of length l. It is imparted a horizontal velocity v0 at the lowest point A. So this is the lowest point A, such that it completes a semicircular trajectory in the vertical plane with the string becoming slack. Slack means the string becomes folded and it will come down only on reaching the top most point C. So it is slack, so it is not going to provide any tension at this place. So this goes from here to here and here to here, and then it slacks and it comes down freely. Obtain an expression from for V0, the speed at points B and C, and the ratio of kinetic energy, that is KB, this one, the kinetic energy at B, kinetic energy at C, and also comment on the nature of the trajectory of the bob after it reaches point C here. So there are two external forces on the bob. What are these? See, let us take the free body diagram. If it is here, there is a tension TA, there is MG here, MG. This TA minus MG, because it is moving now, TA minus MG is, will be equal to half MV square, and here will take half MV0 square. It will only have half MV square here, because at, it is at the lowest point, there is no height here. So this is the first one. Energy will be only half MV0 square, which is here. And if you take the free body diagram, this TA minus MG will be equal to this half MV square, or you can say mv square by L. Okay. Now, how this mv square by L has come? This mv square by L, m into a, acceleration, or you can say v equal to r omega, because this is a circular motion. So we know that mv square by r is the value. So mv square and r is length, right? So this is how TA minus MG equal to MV square by L has come. It is zero. The potential energy is zero at this point. It has only kinetic energy. Now at point C, what is happening? It is at, say, we have velocity VC here. So half MVC square plus, now the height becomes, this is L, this is L. So 2 into L. So MG into H, that is MG into 2L. So half mv square, vc square plus 2mgn. And we also know that in this case, free body diagram or ball is, this is the say tension C, okay, and this is also mg. So we have mg equal to, again we also have this, the similar case mv square by r, we will take mv square by r at this point. So we see at the speed at c. When we take, or when we take these two equation, one and this 13 and 14, then we just try to solve it, we get E equal to 5 by 2 mgn. Now when we equate this to the energy, which is this one, half mv 0 square at this point, we get V0 equal to under root 5 gn. Now Vc can be again computed, because we have this Vc like this, just cut this, Vc becomes under root gn from this equation. Now at B point, it has both the energy, that is half m Vb square velocity at B, and mgl, this is the height, mgl. So what do you get? You get, this is the energy. Now if we have to equate this to the energy at A, because the energy at A and all the points A, B, C will remain same. So we have this V square equal to 5gl. Let us put it here, half mv square plus mgl is equal to half mv0 square. Now V0 square can be easily written as 5mgl, and you get the final as 5 by 2 mgl. And in this case, we get Vb equal to under root gl. Now the ratio of kinetic energy at B and C, Kb and Kc, Kb here and Kc. So this will be half mvb square by Vc, half mv square, m by 2 cancels out, and you get Vb square by Vc square. We just found out and put it here, 3 is to 1. So at point C, the string becomes slack and the velocity of the bob is horizontal to the left. If you happen to cut the string here, if the connecting string is cut at this instant, the ball will execute a projectile motion with horizontal projection akin to a rock kicked horizontally, or it is akin means it's like from the edge of the cliff. If you have a, say, cliff and you happen to kick a rock, the way it goes, the same way this is going to go. The potential energy of a spring. So the potential energy, or you can say the spring force, is an example of variable force, so which is conservative. In this 6.7, these are all the diagram what is happening. We have a block, which is attached to this spring, and it is resting on smooth horizontal surface. The other end of the spring is attached to a rigid wall here. The spring is light and it may be, you can treat it as massless. So for an ideal spring, this spring force Fs is proportional to the distance, we know, and that is the displacement. So x is the displacement of the block from equilibrium position. So this displacement, it can be positive, it can be negative. That is, see, if this is normal position, spring is, we have stretched the block, we have compressed the block. So in this case, it can be negative and positive. So the force of the spring is called the Hooke's law. What is it is called? It is Hooke's law, and we mathematically state it like this: Fs is equal to minus kx. What is this k? K is called the spring constant, and the unit is Newton per meter. So the spring is said to be stiff if k is large, if this k is large, and soft if k is small. It all depends on k. Now when we pull the block outwards like this, if we pull it like this, means it is the normal position we are pulling it. So if the extension is xm, that is from here to here, it is extension from here to here, then the work done by the force or spring force will be what? We know that Fs is minus kx. So energy will be, or the work done will be integration of this Fs with dx, that is this one. So you can take kx dx, so kx dx minus will be here, from 0 to xm, means from here to this point, xm. Now this becomes minus k xm square by 2, by just integrate the x. Now this is the expression which can be obtained by considering the area of a triangle also. You can take the triangle, if this is Fs and x distribution, this is the area of triangle, half into base into altitude. So this is the base, this is the altitude, you will get the same value. And the work done by the force in pulling, this is you are pulling a force, pulling something. So this is positive because you are trying to overcome the spring force. Now the same is true when you compress this spring means here. So this is now your XM, and this will be again the work done will be same, but here the distance is less. The external force, because it cannot be negative, you are pressing it. So if the block is moved from say initial position I to F, the work done by the spring force will from say from I to F will be kx dx. This is Fx, and Fx is by Hooke's law, we have just seen it is minus kx. And we can just take k constant on outside, and this will be x square by 2. These are definite integrals. So this is kxi square, means k by 2 is common, xi square minus xf square. So the work done by spring force depend only on the endpoints, that is initial point and final point. And if the block is pulled from say xi and allowed to return to xi, the work done will be 0, because initial position and final position both will be xi xi. If you just pull or push it and allow it to come to the original position, the work done will be 0. So work done by the spring force in a cyclic process is 0, and because it is though both the things are both the positions are same. So we can just say that spring force is position dependent only in the first, if as first stated by the Hooke's law, Fs equal to minus kx, and does work which only depends on xi and xf, initial and final position, that is the spring force is also conservative force. This is the definition of conservative force also. So we have the, now let us define the potential energy Vx of a spring. So we define the potential energy of Vx to be 0 when the block and spring system, they are in equilibrium position, that is we have not pulled it or pushed it. So for an extension, say you are compressing or extending it, the analysis what we have done says that Vx equal to kx square by 2, like this. And we can easily verify that this minus dv by dx, which is the potential rate, this is what? This is Fx, or you can say F, and this is minus kx by Hooke's law. So if the block of mass m is extended say to xm and it is released to rest, then the total mechanical energy for any point x lies between minus xm and xm, that is this point. This is the equilibrium position. You either say elongate it or pull it or push it. So this is say xm, this is minus xm. In this case, half kxm square will be half kx square plus half mv square. This is the potential energy. And of course, it will have some velocity also. So half mv square is the kinetic energy, which is actually equal to half kxm square, which we already seen. So we have invoked here the conservation of mechanical energy. Total mechanical energy will be equal to the potential energy and kinetic energy. And here we see that if velocity is 0, that means the speed and the kinetic energy will be maximum where? When it is at rest. So at rest, x equal to 0, half mv square will be what? Or you can say x will be equal to 0. So if this becomes 0, half mvm square, that is maximum, you have to put m here, will be equal to half kxm square. So what you get? Vm will be equal to under root k by m xm. So just see that Vm is the maximum speed. This k by m has a dimension t to the power minus 2, and our equation also becomes dimensionally correct. So the kinetic energy, it gets converted to potential energy and vice versa. So total mechanical energy always remains the same. To simulate car accidents, auto manufacturers study the collision of moving cars with mounted springs of different spring constant, that is k. Consider a typical simulation with car of mass 1000 kg moving with a speed this much on a smooth road and colliding with horizontally mounted spring of spring constant k, that is 6.25 into 10 to the power 3. What is the maximum compression of the spring? This is a diagram. Let us, before just going ahead with the answer, let me tell you one more thing. This is the parabolic plot of kinetic energy, which is the velocity, this is the potential energy and the kinetic energy. and these are obeying the Hooke law. Every time you see, when this is higher, this is lower. They both are same here, they both are same here. That means the total mechanical energy E equal to K plus V will always remain constant. Now let us come back again to the question. So at maximum compression, the kinetic energy of the car is converted to what? Entirely into potential energy. So the kinetic energy of moving car is what? Half mv square. Mass you use, it will be 10 to the power 3 because it is 1000 kg. So kinetic energy is this. And how we have come across 5? 18 into 5 by 18, we have converted into meter per second. Now, at maximum compression xm, the potential energy V of a spring is equal to what? Kinetic energy of the moving car. We know that from the principle of conservation of mechanical energy. So, this V will be half kxm square. Just equate it, you will get xm equal to 2.0. This is not the very idealized situation. The spring is considered to be massless. It is not like that always. There are certain remarks we need to discuss on conservative force before we close this discussion. Information on time is absent from the above discussion. So, in this example, we have seen an example considered just now. We can calculate the compression, but not the time over which the compression occurs. So, our solution of Newton's second law for this system, for this, we need certain temporal information, time related information. Also, not all forces are conservative. This friction is a non-conservative force. The principle of conservation of energy, we need to modify it. The zero of the potential energy is arbitrary. It is set according to the convenience. So, for the spring force, we took Vx equal to 0 at x equal to 0. That is, the unstretched spring has zero potential energy. And for constant gravitational force Mg, we have taken V equal to 0 on the Earth surface. But we'll see that this actually, you know, is not very true because we have universal law of gravitation. We'll see how things goes on. Consider a example which we have seen, taking the coefficient of friction mu. This has to be taken as 0.5 and calculate the maximum compression of the spring. We have friction. So, in the presence of friction, both the spring force and the friction force act so as to oppose the compression of the spring. So, spring will also say, I don't want to be stretched or compressed. The friction force will also say, I don't want this body to move. We will invoke the work energy theorem here, not the conservation of mechanical energy. So, the change in kinetic energy is what? See, delta K will be Kf minus Ki. Initially it was half mv square. Finally, it was zero. Okay. So, because we are trying to compress it. So, work done by the net force will be what? This W will be half K xm square minus of mu mg xm, right? So, when we equate these two, you know this, why we have work done like this? Say, this is kx, this is mu mg. How this mu mg has come? We know that this friction force is mu into fk, right? So, this mg has come, which is normal, n is equal to mg. So, n is equal to mg. So, mg into mu, and then when we, this is total force, and xm is, because we know that energy is force into displacement. So, xm is the maximum compression we are talking about. So, mu into mg into xm is the energy. That is the, you can say the energy, or you can say the energy by the friction force, work done by the friction force. And this is, we have already seen in the previous discussion, this is half kxm square by the spring. So, this is by friction, this is by spring. Now, when we equate these two, we get an equation like this. Now, we put the values, we have mu mg like this, and we can just rearrange this equation. We have a solution to this equation, and this xm becomes this value. So, we take the positive root because the distance cannot be negative, and we put all these numerical values, we get xm equal to, xm is the maximum one. Maximum compression distance, like 1.35. So, if two forces on the body, they consist of a conservative force Fc, we are this F sub C, C is for conservative force, and non-conservative, this is Fnc, Nc for non-conservative force. The conservation of mechanical energy, we can modify it by just putting fc plus fnc both together into delta x as delta t. But we know that the conservative force, in the case of conservative force, fc into delta x is minus delta b, that we have already seen. Now just compare and add these two, we get delta k plus v is fnc delta x. So in fact, this delta e energy, or total energy, you can say fnc into delta x, this e is the total mechanical energy. We have a path, so we can say EF, final energy, minus EI will be equal to work done by the non-conservative force. This WNC is the total work done by the non-conservative force over certain path. So, unlike conservative force, this WNC depends on initial and final position. Various forms of energy, the energy of conservation of energy. So, we have seen total mechanical energy, we have seen by virtue of motion, we have kinetic energy, by virtue of position, it has potential energy. But there are certain different energies also, like the heat. You know, you will always see when collision is happening, then there will be some sort of heat being produced. If something is sliding also, there is a friction down there, so there will be some heat. So there will be a lost energy, or you can say there is always some energy being lost in the form of heat. You rub your hand in winter, why? Because you want to make them warm. And a transfer of heat energy is obtained by nothing that 1 kg of water releases about 42,000 of energy when it is cooling by 10 degrees centigrade. So this is the idea which I want to give, that how this heat becomes important as an energy. Then chemical energy is whenever something is happening, there is chemical things also going on. So this chemical energy is also there for conversion from one chemical form to another. That is, we have exothermic, endothermic reaction in which the heat is absorbed, heat is released here, heat is absorbed here. For example, the coal consists of carbon, and kilogram of it when burned, it releases 3 × 10⁻⁷. All these combustion of coal, cooking gas, wood, petroleum, these are indispensable, and they are taking the form of, or they are utilizing the chemical energy form. Then electrical energy is also very important, or bulbs, fan, these are all having the electrical energy. Energy is associated with electric current. For example, an urban Indian household, it consumes around 200 joule of energy per second on an average. The equivalence of mass and energy, till the end of 19th century, physicists believed that in every physical and chemical process, the mass of isolated system is conserved. So matter might change its phase. For example, glacier ice will become to stream, but matter is neither created nor destroyed. Then came Albert Einstein. He showed that mass and energy are equivalent, and they are related by what? A very famous equation, Einstein equation, E equal to mc square. C is the speed of light, which is in vacuum, 3 × 10⁸. So a staggering amount of energy is associated with just a kilogram of matter. See, this is a kilogram of matter. If you take C square, this is speed of light, it is 9 × 10⁻⁙ joule. This is equivalent to the annual for a year electrical output of a very large 3000 megawatt power generating station. We have nuclear energy, most destructive and most beneficial also, fusion bombs, etc. This is the approximate energy associated with various phenomena. Just have a look on this so that you understand what is going on, how much energy is produced. We have nuclear fission, nuclear fusion. They also release a lot of energy. Nuclear weapons are being made, and this energy is being harnessed. Fission, fusion are being harnessed for creation of electricity. This is a table, so we'll take the values from this table. You just have to go through this table. Now in this table, examine this, and the energy required to break one bond in DNA in electron volt, the kinetic energy of an air molecule 10⁻²⁰ joule in electric volt, and the daily intake of human adult in kilocalories. So the energy required to break one bond of DAs, we have to go to the table. We will take 10⁻²⁰, and this is of course joule and electron volt conversion. So we divide by this. This is equivalent to 0.06 electron volt. See, 0. electron volt is 100 milli electron volt. This is 100 milli electron volt. Air molecule, again, we'll go to the table. This is the value divided by 1.6 10 to the power minus 19, which is the conversion from joule to electron volt. You get this value. The average human consumption, again, 10 to the power 7, and this is the kilocalorie and joule, the conversion. So this is just an, you know, way of representing energy in different form. The principle of conservation of energy says that energy cannot be created, cannot be destroyed. It can only be transformed from one, say, form to another. Okay. So we have seen that the total mechanical energy of the system is conserved if the force or forces they are doing work on it, they are conservative. If some of the forces are non-conservative also, then the part of the mechanical energy, this may get transferred into other form like the heat, light and sound. But the total energy of any isolated system do not change. It does not change as long as one accounts for all forms of energy like the heat, light and sound. Energy can be transformed, may be transformed from one form to another, but the total energy of the isolated system always remain constant. Let me re-emphasize that energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. Power. Not only the work done on the object is important, but also what is the rate at which the work is done is also to be considered. We can say that a person is physically fit if he not only climbs four floors of a building, but he is climbing very fast. So power is defined as the rate at which work is done, or you can say at the rate at which energy is transferred. So the average power of a force can be defined as the ratio of the work, that is this one, to the total time taken. So power is work by time, energy by time. Any instantaneous power for a very short time, we need to limit the value delta t to very, very small value, so it approaches zero. Now the power becomes dw by dt. This dw is work done by the force for certain displacement dx. So we say dw is equal to what? We know that dw is simply f into this, say dr is the distance. Okay. So the instantaneous power can be expressed as, let us put w, replace this w with f dr. F comes outside this dr by dt. This is a dot product. So it is dr by dt is what? It is velocity. So force into velocity. In this case, force is the force and v is the instantaneous velocity when the force F is applied. So power, like the work energy, this is also a scalar quantity. The dimensions are ml square t minus 3. The unit is, SI unit is watt. And this is in the name of James Watt and honor of James Watt. 1 watt is 1 joule per second. James Watt, he is one of the innovators of steam engine in the 18th century. There is another popular unit of power, which is horsepower, HP. This horsepower is related to watt with this number. So 1 horsepower is 746 watt. Okay. This is still in use. You will see in automobiles and motorbikes, this horsepower is being used. So we encounter this unit watt when we are buying electrical goods like the bulbs, the heaters and the refrigerators. A 100 watt bulb, which is on say for 10 hours, it uses how much? 1 kilowatt hour of energy. So 100 watt, so 100 watt, time is 10 hour. So this gives you 1000 watt hour. Take it as 1 kilo. So it will be 1 kilowatt hour. Take this 10 by 3, that is watt. Convert this hour into second. So this is 3600 second. So now this watt and second becomes joule. So 3.6 into 10 to the power 6. You will often see that the electric bills carry the energy consumption unit in kilowatt hour. Please understand that kilowatt hour is unit of energy, not the power. An elevator can carry a maximum load of 1800 kg.
that is elevator plus the passengers, this is moving up with a constant speed of 2 meter per second. So there is an elevator, it is moving up with constant speed. So constant speed is there. The frictional force opposing the motion, the friction force which is opposing the motion is 4000 Newton. Now we have to determine the minimum power delivered by the motor to the elevator in watts, also in horsepower. So now the directions are like this. We have mg here, the friction force is acting against it, so ff. So this ff, and since it is moving up, so when it is moving up, the friction force is not in this direction, but it will be in the opposite direction. So friction force will be ff. So ff plus mg is the final force. Final force will be this f, that is friction force plus mg. Now put all these values which are given in the question, you get 22,000. Now the motor must supply enough power in order to balance this force. What will be the power? Force into the velocity, which is 2 meter per second. So this gives you 44,000. You want to convert it into horsepower, use 746, and you get divided by 746, you get 59 horsepower. Collisions. So in physics, we study motion, that is how the position are changing. But we try to discover also some physical quantities which are not changing in physical process, like the laws of momentum and energy conservation. These are typical examples, instances of that. We'll try to apply these laws to commonly seen phenomena like the collisions. Collision is just the way two or three objects, they collide, means the billiards, the marbles and the carom, these are all games of collisions. And we will study the collision of two masses in an idealized form. So we considered two mass, we'll be considering this. So you have to learn this and observe this figure very carefully, because all other things which are coming are dependent on this diagram. Having an initial velocity, say I, this velocity V1I, and this mass 2. Now when this mass 1 is colliding with M2, then this mass 1 is going here with some final velocity, and this mass 2 is going here with some final velocity. So from the horizontal, here means it is making an angle of theta 1 degree, this is making an angle of theta 2 degree, means they are flying off in different directions. So elastic and inelastic collisions, there are many questions which are being asked on this elastic and inelastic collision. So in all collisions, the total linear momentum is conserved. This is very important. Total linear momentum is conserved. The initial momentum of the system will be equal to the final momentum of the system. So how to argue on this? When two objects, they collide, that means two objects are there, when they are going to collide, that means the mutual repulsive forces which are acting on, or you can say impulsive force acting over this collision time delta t, can cause the change in their respective momentum. Let us take this one. This is the change in the momentum. This is F12. 12 is the force exerted on the first particle by 2. This is the delta t time. So you know that this change in momentum is force into delta t time. For delta t, they are in contact. Then delta P2 will be the force exerted by the second particle on 1, and the time remains the same. In this case, by the Newton third law of motion, the F12 will be equal to minus F21, equal and opposite force will be there, because this is exerting force here, this is going to exert force here, means equal and opposite. So 12 will be equal to 21, the forces. So when we take this equation, these two equation becomes delta P1 plus delta P2 equal to 0, and this conclusion shows that the momentum remains the same even after and before. So this conclusion is true even though the force acting in a complex fashion, as you saw during the collision time delta t. And since the third law is true here, at every instant this will be true. Third law is true everywhere. So the total impulse on the first object will be equal and opposite to that of the second. What about the total kinetic energy of the system? It will not be necessarily conserved, because what is happening when they are impacting? See, if they are impacting, that means you will hear a sound, you will see some heat also. So part of the initial kinetic energy is transformed into another energy also, like the heat and the sound. So the way in order to visualize the deformation during the collision, you can see in terms of a compressed spring. So if this spring connecting two masses regain its original shape without any loss in energy, then the initial kinetic energy is equal to the final kinetic energy. But the kinetic energy during the collision, this at delta t time, is not constant. That is why we call it as elastic collision, right? This type of collision are elastic collision. What is then inelastic or other collision? See, the deformation may not be relieved, and the two bodies could move together after the collision. That means two bodies striking or coming say head on, and they are combining, and now they are moving together, right, after the collision. So the collision in which the two particles, they move together after the collision, that means they are not going to separately go in different directions, but they will together be a system, and then they will move forward. This is called as completely inelastic collision. So there is an intermediate case also, where the deformation is partly relieved and some of the initial kinetic energy is lost, that is in heat or some sound. This is more common, and this is known as inelastic collision. Let us talk collision in one dimension. As we see here, the completely inelastic collision in one dimension, if this is the figure, see, in completely inelastic collision, this M1 and M2, they are going to be together after collision. So when this collides with this one, this M1 joins with M2. So M1 joins with M2, and they together goes in some direction or the same direction, you can say. So what is the initial momentum? M1 into V1I. And this M1, say M1 comes here and it strikes it. So M1 plus M2 into some final velocity. So what will be the final velocity? We divide, or we take this into the denominator. This will be M1 by M1 plus M2 V1I. What is the loss in the kinetic energy on collision? See, delta K, that is the change in the kinetic energy, will be half into M1 into V1I square minus half into M1 plus M2 into some VF square. Okay, let us put this VF, this one, in this place. So we get some value here, which is in terms of V1I. Take half M1 V1I common. So you get something inside like this. Just rearrange it and you get a value, or you can say an expression like this. Now let us take the elastic collision. And we have just seen the nomenclature where we say theta 1, theta 2 equal to 0. The momentum and kinetic energy conservation in this case will be M1 V1 I will be equal to M1 when it strikes. So M1 V1 F plus M2 V2 F. This is the momentum equation. If you put half here, this is the kinetic energy conservation law. So the initial kinetic energy will be the addition of the first and second kinetic energy of these two particles separately. So in order to solve this, we can just rearrange and try to solve it. We get some equation. This is A square minus B square type. So this would be A minus B, A plus B. That is, you can just rearrange this. You get V2F in terms of the first one. The second velocity comes in terms of the initial and final velocity of the first one. Now let us substitute this in this equation. So we get a value of V1F. Similarly, we get a value of V2F. You just have to, you know, resolve. This is just like any other equation. So you have to consider and you have to worry about this V1F and V2F. So the unknowns, V1F and V2F, these are obtained in terms of known, which is M1, M2 and V1I. We are aware of this. So there are certain special cases which are very interesting to know. First is, if the two masses are equal, if m1 is equal to m2, this becomes 0. Okay. And how about this? If m1 is equal to m2, this becomes 2m, this becomes m, just cancel them out. You get v2f equal to v1i. So the first mass comes to rest and it pushes off the second mass with its initial speed on collision. I hope you got the idea. Means it is striking the second one. This comes to rest and this goes off with the same velocity. Same velocity which by which the first one is striking. The second situation is the one mass, if it is dominating, say m2 is very large value than m1. So if you just put it here, and since m2 is very large, you can just say ignore this m1. So essentially this, if you say it is 0, v2f will be 0. Essentially if you say okay, m1 can be just you can just relieve it or you can ignore it. So this gets cancelled out and you get one v1i in the negative direction. So v1f is equal to, or you can say equivalent to, minus v1i and v2f equal to or equivalent to 0. So the heavier mass is undisturbed while the lighter mass reverses its velocity. What it means is there is a lighter mass, there is a greater mass. It strikes it, this one has no change, but this one reverses. It comes like this and goes like this. Next is slowing down of neutrons. We are taking a example. So what this says is, in a nuclear reactor, a neutron of high speed, typically say 10 to the power 7 meter per second, must be slowed to 10 to the power 3 meter per second so that it can have high probability of interacting with isotope, uranium isotope, and causing it to a phenomena called fission. Show that a neutron can lose most of its kinetic energy in an elastic collision with light nuclei like deuterium and carbon, which has mass of only a few times the neutron mass. The material making up the light nuclei, usually heavy water, D2O, or graphite, is called a moderator. The question is like this. Let us see one by one the kinetic energy, initial kinetic energy of the neutron. Say K1i will be half m1 into v1i square. What is the final kinetic energy? Kinetic energy will be K1f half m1 v1 square, final velocity. This we will take from this equation. This equation, okay? V1f. So what will be v1f? This will be, the final velocity will be half mv square, but here we are going to take v1f. So let us take from this equation we just saw, m1 minus m2 by m1 plus m2 whole square in terms of v1i. So the fractional kinetic energy loss will be, just divide these two. So divide k1f by k1i. So you get some equation like this. So this is simply a rearrangement. The fractional kinetic energy which is gained by the moderating nuclei, K2F, now we have talked about K1F and K1I. But what is the fractional kinetic energy which is gained by moderating nuclei as asked in the question? It is K2F by K1I. What it will be, F2 has to be, because it is in an inelastic collision. So you can say F2 plus F1 is 1. F1 plus F2 is 1. Okay. The kinetic energy. But we can find out F2 by transferring F2, F1 here. Put this F1 value in this equation, you get a equation like this, or you can say an expression like this. So we can just verify the result just by substituting the value. For deuterium, we know M2 equal to 2M1, and we obtain F1 is 1 by 9, F2 is 8 by 9. Just put the value, and 90% of, almost 90% of the neutron energy is transferred to deuterium. Carbon, we have F1 as 71.6%, fraction F2 is 28.4%, and this is how we solve it. So this, see, if we have a body, two bodies which are coming in opposite direction, and if they now strike, then we call it as a head-on collision. Collision in two dimension. So we have seen a figure which is coming like this. So there is a mass striking here. The masses are going like this. So this is theta 1, this is theta 2. Okay. Now when we are talking about two dimension, so this is m1, this is m2. m1 is coming and m2 is stationary. So linear momentum is conserved in such a collision. Since the momentum is a vector, so this implies we have three equation for the three direction x, y, z. So just consider this plane determined by the certain final velocity. So m1 and m2 we have to choose for, say, x, y plane. The conservation of the z component of linear momentum will imply that the entire collision has to be in xy plane. So the conservation of the z component, as is, it is implying xy plane, it has to have collision in xy plane. So the xy component will be something like this. This m1 with v1f, it strikes. Now when the m1 goes in this direction, it is a horizontal component. This is m1 v1f cos theta 1. And how about m2? It goes like this. So it has a horizontal component, m2 v2f cos theta 2. Okay, so this horizontal component will be initial and these two addition, so this one and this one. How about vertical component? See, it is going in the horizontal direction, so there is no vertical component, so it will be zero. But m1 has vertical component, this one, which is going to m1 v1f sin theta 1. In this case m2, so it has opposite direction, so we have to use minus. This is m2 v2, now v2f, this is not cos theta, now sin theta. So sin theta 1, sin theta 2, and we are using minus. So these are the two equations. But we are aware of the mass m1, m2 and initial velocity. But we have to find four unknowns, which is this one, and theta 1 and theta 2. But we have only two equations, one equation and two equation. How to find others? If theta 1 and theta 2 are 0, then we just come to the one dimension. And we also have, say, one more equation of collision. If it is elastic, that the initial energy, the kinetic energy, will be the sum of final two kinetic energy. So we get an additional equation. But still, we have this third equation. We are short because we want to find out four unknowns. We need at least four equations for this. So we need to know at least one of them, that is theta 1 or theta 2. Then only this problem is solvable. So for this theta 1 to be known, we can use detector in an angular fashion from x to y axis. Then if you have m1, m2, this is also known, theta 1 is also known using the detector, then we can now find out the final velocity and theta 2. We'll take an example. Consider the collision which is depicted in this. Okay, this was this. Between two billiard balls, the masses are equal. So m1 is equal to m2. So both has mass, say m. The first ball is called the Q, while the second ball is called the target. This is Q, this is target. The billiard player wants to sink the target ball in corner pocket, which is at an angle of, say, theta 2, 37 degree. Assume that the collision is elastic and that frictional and rotational motions are not important. You can ignore this. You have to obtain theta 1. We'll start with the momentum conservation. Since the masses are equal, you can just write m here. The initial momentum will be equal to the final momentum of these two. So initial momentum of these two will be the final momentum of these two. And just, we are not writing m because they will anyways be cancelled out. And we can write half m here, half m here, half m here. Okay. But we will do what? We'll not use this. We'll just square them. So we squaring of this will give you this dot this. So now we'll multiply this with this, this with this, this with this, and this with this. So you get v1f square, v2f square, and 2 v1f dot v2f. Okay. What is this? We take the dot product. So this will be 2 V1F V2F cos and theta 1 plus 37 degree. We are talking about whole angle. One angle is known, 37. This angle is not known. So we are writing it as theta 1. And since the collision is elastic and masses are also equal, so if now here we'll use half m. I am writing half m because I just want to tell you that we have cancelled this half m. This is essentially the kinetic energy conservation equation. So V1 initial will be equal to V1 and V2 final. Let us take this one and this one. Now compare these two. So you get cos theta 1 plus 37 is 0. Theta 1 plus 37 means this 0 means this has to be 90 degree. Theta 1 become 53 degree. This also proves one thing: when two equal masses undergo a glancing elastic collision with one of them is at rest, after the collision, they will move at right angles to each other. So this collision is very normal thing. This happens in normal life, and when they are colliding, some can change velocity, some can come to rest, and this totally depends on their interaction, their masses, shapes and size. One important event is called scattering because of this collision. Let us summarize the work energy power. The work energy theorem is stating that the change in the kinetic energy, that is Kf minus Ki, of a body is the work done, that is the work done by the net force on the body. If the force is conservative, when is the force conservative? There are certain conditions to be met. First is, work done by it on an object is path independent. That means it is only depending on the initial position and final position. The second condition for the force to be conservative is, the work done by the force is zero for an arbitrary closed path. If the path is closed, it has to be zero. Then we say the force is conservative. For a conservative force in one dimension, we may define potential energy function Vx like this, Fx equal to minus dvx by dx, and this is simply Vi minus Vx integration of initial to final Fx dx. We are just taking the integral of these two. The principle of conservation of mechanical energy is stating that the total mechanical energy, that is T total mechanical energy TME, remain constant if only forces that act on body, they are conservative. Okay. The gravitational potential energy of particles, say of mass m at a height x above the earth like this, is given by mgx. Mg is the weight, h is the height from here to here. So vx will be equal to mgx. G is the gravity. The elastic potential energy of a spring of force constant k with an extension x is given by half kx square. The scalar and dot product of two vectors, say A and B, is represented by A dot B. And this is a scalar quantity. A dot B is simply A, B cos theta. Theta is the angle between A, B. So it can be positive, negative or zero depending on the value of theta. The scalar product of two vectors can be interpreted as the product of magnitude of one vector and component of, say, this is A and this is B. So multiplication of A with component of B on A. So A, this will be component B cos theta. So A into B cos theta. Similarly, you can take the component of A on B. For unit vectors, I dot A, J dot J, K dot A is going to give you 1. Ij, jk, ki will give you 0. Scalar products, they obey the commutative and distributive laws. These are the physical quantity we discussed, work, which is F into D shown by W. All these work, kinetic energy and potential energy, they are expressed in terms of joules. So we can take mechanical energy also. So kinetic energy represented by K is half mv square. Potential energy represented by Vx. Sometimes it is represented by P also. Because this P and P are same, that is why we represent it by Vx. It is given by minus dvx by dx. Total mechanical energy is simply kinetic energy plus the V, that is the mgh, or you can say potential energy, spring constant is given by, we have said two equations here, f equal to minus kx, this is the coefficient of this spring, and this compression or extraction, and vx is minus half kx square. Power is given by f dot v, or you can say dw by dt, rate of change of energy or work. So this is all about the discussion on the topic of work, energy and power. Thank you so much and take care of yourself.